Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. We're happy to have you worshiping with us today. This is August the 28th. We have been doing for 60 years the drive-in service, and this morning we had communion at the drive-in service for those who are unable to receive communion any other way. We see this as our mission. Also, this is the 15th Sunday after Pentecost, service of the Word. You see our pastor, Pastor Pollock, starting the service. We will confess our sins as God has asked us to confess before others.
Good morning.
Good morning.
And welcome to our worship service this morning. This being a non-communion Sunday for the summer, we are using the service that we use at the drive-in. Of course, this will be the last Sunday we do this, since the drive-in ends next week. And of course, being the first Sunday of the month, we'll be celebrating the Lord's Supper. So all the hymns are in your bulletin this morning. The only thing you need your hymnal for it is for right now, and that is to turn to the order of confession and forgiveness on page 94 in the front of your worship book. And by those who can do so without difficulty, please stand as we prepare our hearts and minds for worship with the order of confession and forgiveness. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Almighty God, to whom our hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name.
Amen.
In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. As a call-ordained minister of the Church of Christ and by his authority, therefore declare you the entire forgiveness of all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
We now begin our worship with Come Now, Father, to Every Blessing, page 3 in your book. glad in. We welcome you in the name of God the Father who has created us, God the Son who has redeemed us, and God the Holy Spirit who sanctifies and keeps us in the true faith. Amen. Let us pray. O God, you resist those who are proud and give grace to those who are humble. Give us the humility of your Son, that we may embody the generosity of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. You may be seated as we listen to the reading of God's Word, and we will sing the song in between the first and second lesson. It's not printed there because, of course, it's a draft, and there's no way to sing a song responsibly, but we will sing it after the first lesson.
Gina Pollock is doing the reading today.
A reading from Proverbs.
It's a reading from Proverbs, 15th Sunday after Pentecost, August the 28th.
For it is better to be told, come up here, than to be put lower in the presence of the noble, the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thanks be to God. of the Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the 14th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. On one occasion, when Jesus was going to the house of the Pharisees to eat a meal on the Sabbath, they were watching him closely. When he noticed how the guests chose the places of honor, he told them a parable. When you're invited by someone to a wedding banquet, do not sit down at the place of honor, in case someone more distinguished than you has been invited by your host, and the host who invited both of you may come and say to you, give this person your place, and then in disgrace, you would start to take the lowest place. But when you are invited, go and sit down in the lowest place, so that when your host comes, he may say to you, friend, move up high. Then you will be honored in the presence of all who sit at the table with you. For all who exalt themselves will be humbled, and those who humble themselves will be exalted. He said also to the one who had invited him, when you give a luncheon or a dinner, do not invite your friends or your brothers or your relatives or rich neighbors, in case they may invite you in return and you would be repaid. But when you give a banquet, invite the poor, the crippled, the lame, and the blind, and you will be blessed, because they cannot repay you, for you will be repaid at the resurrection of the righteous. The Gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
You may be seated as we sing This Is My Father's World, page 4 in your worship.
He lives and rules among us now and for all eternity.
Harvey Baker is singing a solo this morning. This is in, goes along with our readings. This is the 15th Sunday after Pentecost, August 28th, 2016, St. John's Lutheran Church. And the theme is, God, you resist those who are proud, give grace to those who are humble. We're advocating humility today in our lesson.
To obliterate themselves and to
If you are listening to someone who claims to be a preacher of the gospel, and they are turning you to themselves, or to someone else, or to something else, you want to jump up out of your pew or chair or whatever that you are sitting on, depending on the church you're in, and flee. Because if that person is not pointing you to Jesus Christ, they are not the preacher of the gospel. In our second lesson for today, as I have told you at the beginning of our readings from the Apostle's letter to the Hebrews, this apostle is writing to a predominantly Jewish Christian community of faith. And this particular community of faith has been undergoing persecution. And because of the continuous persecution, some of the members have become discouraged, disappointed, and filled with despair. Some are considering going back to Judaism and forsaking the Christian faith. And so the apostle from the first chapter of this letter has laid out to the community how Jesus is superior to the angels, how Jesus is superior to Moses, and how Jesus is superior to all the prophets of the Old Testament, and how Jesus is indeed the one who fulfills all those Old Testament prophets. That he is indeed the Christ, the Messiah, the anointed one, the long-awaited Savior that God had promised. And so as he writes this 13th chapter today, and the words that we're going to focus on, verses 7 and 8, he is bringing their attention back to Jesus. He's showing them Jesus and having them focus on Jesus. For so doing, he is telling them that they will be able to handle the changes, the chances, and the challenges of life. They'll be able to handle the discouragement, the despair, the disappointment. They'll be able to handle the trials, tragedies, and tribulations that come up in your pilgrimage on earth. But to do so, you must stay focused on Jesus Christ and what he taught us. So he writes in verses 7 and 8, quote, "Remember your leaders, those who spoke to you the word of God. Consider the outcome of their way of life and imitate their faith. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday and today and forever." With these two verses, the apostle is giving us a prescription for fighting discouragement, disappointment, and despair, for fighting through trials, tragedies, and tribulations, for handling the changes, the chances, and challenges. Now, we may not suffer persecution for the faith like the community to whom he is writing. We are fortunate to live in a country where we are guaranteed the right to worship as we desire by the First Amendment to the Constitution. But we will face changes, challenges, and chances in life. We will face trials, tragedies, and tribulations. We will have times when we are discouraged, when we are disappointed, or when we are filled with despair. And so the words of the apostle writing this letter to the Hebrews are as relevant for us today as they were to the community of faith to whom he is writing back in that first century AD. So let us now look at verse 7 and 8 and see what this prescription is as we continue our pilgrimage of faith upon this earth. First stage, remember. Remember your leaders and those who spoke the word of God to you. Now the word remember, it means to be mindful of someone. It means to observe them in their life, to think of them. It means to observe the teachings of the one who is remembered. So as the apostle is writing this letter, he is telling us to remember the teachers and teachings of who gave us the Word of God. He is telling us to remember how they taught us with enthusiasm and conviction. He is telling us to remember how they pointed us to Jesus Christ, the way, the truth, and the life. As I look back over my life, the older I've become, I find more and more each south side of Louisville. And I can remember all those teachers on from my grandmother on up through high school. Likewise, as I look back on my life and continue to become older, I can remember all of my seminary professors. I can even remember some of the advice they gave me. I can remember some of their lectures. But I cannot say the same for my college professors. Now, there were several college professors that I do remember who made an impact on me or to whom I was especially close to. But for the most part, it cannot compare to those who taught me about the Word of God. It cannot compare to those who taught me about our Lord Jesus Christ. And so the apostle is telling us when we face trial, tragedy, and tribulation, when we feel disappointed, discouraged, or filled with despair, think about those teachers and think about the message they taught us about Jesus Christ. Recall how they pointed us to Jesus Christ, the same yesterday and today and forever. To recall how they shared with us his life and his teachings, how they shared with us his promises, and how he sealed those promises with his innocent blood, suffering, and death upon the cross, so that we might be his own and live under him in his kingdom. So the first step of the prescription is to remember. The second step, the second stage of the prescription, is to consider. Consider the outcome of their way of life. Consider their way of life, the teachers that you had. The word consider means to observe carefully, to observe attentively, to put all your focus and energy on a certain subject or topic, whatever it is, to not be distracted, to not be led astray, focusing totally on what's before you. So the apostle is telling us, when we face severe problems in life, consider the lives that our teachers had and what they went through to teach us each week in Sunday school, or if we went to a parochial school, to teach us each day, school day, about our Lord Jesus Christ, and then our Sunday school teachers and Bible school teachers teaching us on Sundays and during the weeks of vacation Bible school. He's telling us also to think about the teachers of the past, and most importantly, to think about our Lord Jesus Christ. He is telling us to consider that what St. Peter and St. Paul went through in order to spread the good news of the gospel and to witness to Jesus Christ. To think about the other heroes of the faith, such as Polycarp and Irenaeus. To think about Jerome and Augustine and Gregory the Great. To think about Lutheran and Langton and other heroes of the faith who were teachers who witnessed to that word of Jesus Christ. When there's trouble, think, consider, be attentive to what they taught you and how they lived. Consider most of all our Lord Jesus Christ and what he went through to bring us the truth and salvation. In my own life, whenever I start feeling down, whenever I start feeling sorry for myself, whenever I think I've been dealt a bad hand, I start thinking about all that Jesus went through in order to make me his child. I think about his horrible suffering and death that he willingly underwent so that you and I would not be a condemned sinner, but instead an heir to the kingdom. I also think about what St. Peter, St. Paul, and the other disciples went through as they witnessed to Jesus Christ in the Roman world, and how all of them except for St. John were martyred in one way or another. This past Wednesday was the festival of St. Bartholomew. We're told that St. Bartholomew preached in India, Persia, North Africa, and Armenia, and that eventually he was flayed alive and then beheaded. When you contemplate something like that, your own troubles don't seem quite as bad. Or I think about Martin Luther and what it must have been like for him to stand up boldly When I had my surgery on my shoulder on July 12th, before surgery, I was fortunate enough to have received a nerve block, which blocked the pain. My surgery was at 7:30. It was over about 10 o'clock. From what my wife tells me, it was sometime after 10 that the surgeon came out to speak to her and tell her that it was over. It took a little longer than expected because the damage was greater than what he had expected. And so from 10 o'clock when that surgery ended until 10 o'clock that night, I had no pain because of that nerve block. Then a little bit after 10, suddenly my shoulder felt like someone was taking a sword that they had put over a fire and got red hot and was jabbing it into my shoulder. So immediately, of course, I called for the nurse and asked for pain medicine. Well, they brought the pain medicine. I took it, but as most of you are familiar with, more times than not, when you take pain medicine, it doesn't work immediately. You have to give it time to work. And so as I was waiting for that pain medicine to work, I was beginning to become more frustrated and aggravated with the pain in my shoulder. And then I happened to look up to the wall across from my bed. And those of you familiar with Springfield Regional are familiar with the fact that on the wall across from a patient's bed is a cross. And I focused my eyes on that cross and on the suffering of our Lord Jesus Christ. And with that, I was able to put up with the pain, and it didn't seem quite as bad until the pain medicine began to work. So when we consider all that Jesus went through, the apostles, the martyrs, the early teachers, when we think about what our own Sunday school teachers and Bible school teachers went through, when we think about what our parochial school teachers went through, then it puts our situation in perspective and reminds us that no matter what we are facing, it is nothing compared to those who went before us. Jesus never promised us a rose garden. Jesus never promised us that to follow him would be easy. In fact, Jesus warned us that to follow him we would have to take up our cross and that the world would hate us. He even warned us that by following him, it could put us at odds with members of our family. Mother against daughter, father against son, brother against sister, mother-in-law against daughter-in-law, father-in-law against son-in-law, and so forth. But what he did promise us is that we would never be alone. That he would never let us go through anything by ourselves, but that he would always be with us. That he would always be there standing by us. As he told us in the Great Commission in Matthew 28:19-20, he ends by saying, "Lo, I am with you always to the close of the age." So when we're in a difficult situation, the apostle is telling us, remember those words of Jesus, that he is with us to the close of the age. He also gives us the Holy Spirit. And that Holy Spirit gives us the strength and gives us gifts that we need to face the changes, the chances, and challenges of life. To face the trials, tragedies, and tribulations, the despair, the disappointment, the discomfort that we may have from day to day. Depressed, discouraged, disappointed. Consider not just the teachers you had who taught you the word and what they do, but also consider Jesus Christ, the apostles, and the early teachers and martyrs of the church. Which brings us into that third stage in the prescription that the apostle is giving us today, and that is to imitate. Remember, consider, now imitate. Imitate their faith, he tells us. That word imitate means to follow someone, to follow their example, to be like the example you are following, or to live your life like the example you are following. The apostle is telling us that our teachers and preachers and those who have gone before us have given us a faith and a way of life to follow and to imitate. As the apostle writing this letter said earlier in chapter 12, verse 2, which we studied a week or so ago, he reminds us in that second verse that Jesus is the founder and perfecter of our faith. Or as other translations have it, he is the pioneer of our faith, or he is the author of our faith. And I explained to you how that word literally means trailblazer. That Jesus is the trailblazer of our faith. That he laid out the path for us. He laid out how we're to live in relationship to God and one another. He laid out the path for us, how we're to handle those who hate us and those who dislike us. He laid out the path for us to follow. And so as his children, we are to follow that path that he has laid out and not veer from. When I was growing up at my grandmother's farm in elementary school in Fairdale, Kentucky, her farm had a large woods. And I used to love to go down into that woods and look for snakes and blackberries. And the woods was large enough so that if I had gone deep enough into it, I would have come up on the total side, opposite side of the farm, onto a road that was miles away from the farmhouse and been lost. But I was fortunate in the fact that my mother was the youngest of four children. And like often cases when there are a number of children in a family, my mother was 3 or 4 years younger than the third child, which made her almost 10 years or more younger than the oldest two children. And so, of course, they had children who were much older than I was. So these cousins of mine were like in high school and out of high school when I was just in elementary. And when one of those cousins had a love for that woods like I did, and they had gone down years before and they had marked the path to how to go through the woods and go to the blackberry bushes where the best blackberries were, and to go to the two ponds that were in the woods if you wanted to fish or wanted to try to catch frogs or turtles or whatever, and how then to lead back out so that you came out to the pasture that led alongside the farmhouse, so then you could then walk through the pasture and to the back door to the house. Had I not paid attention to that path that my cousin had marked, I would have gotten lost. And I would have had a heck of a time finding my way back home. Well, Jesus has laid out that path for us. And as long as we stay on that path, as long as we imitate his life, we will not be lost. But to go off that path endangers us to become lost. So our teachers that we had, and those teachers who went before us, gave us that lifestyle to imitate. They told us about Jesus and focused on Jesus so that we would imitate his life. Imitating and following their example, we live a life of discipleship to Jesus Christ. And that is the entire purpose of following Jesus, to be his disciple. The purpose of following Jesus is not just to have a head knowledge of his teachings and of his life that you can explain to people. The purpose in following Jesus is not to form an emotional attachment to Jesus that you need recharged every so many months by the next revival that takes place in town. The purpose in following Jesus is to become a disciple. The word disciple means to imitate or follow the lifestyle and instructions of a teacher. So then as a disciple of Jesus Christ, we are to imitate him in our daily lives. We're to imitate his actions in all that we do. Martin Luther explained it this way by saying this famous quote, quote, "We are to be a little Christ unto our neighbor in the world." This means to be an imitator of Jesus Christ in all aspects of life, not just on Sunday, or not when we're trying to impress somebody. It means all aspects of life. Shopping, at our job, participating in a hobby or a sport, driving down the highway, living in a neighborhood. No matter what we do, all aspects of our life We are to be that little Christ. We are to be that imitator of Jesus. Even when we are dealing with people who are difficult, even when we are dealing with people who have different views than we do, even when we are dealing with people who are on the opposite side of a hot button issue, whether it is something that in politics, society, education, sports, or no matter what field it is in, we are to imitate Jesus. We are to be that little Christ. To imitate and follow Jesus Christ as those teachers he sent to us gives us the ability to face the changes, the chances, and challenges of life. To face the trials, tragedies, and tribulations. To rise above the discouragement, the disappointment, and the despair. Life can be difficult, as we all know. But as a disciple of Jesus Christ, no matter how difficult life may become, we never give up because we have Jesus Christ walking with us. When life is difficult, the apostle is telling us to hold fast to the words of our Lord Jesus Christ and to follow his simple prescription to remember, to consider, and to imitate. This takes place as long as the preacher and the teacher keep you focused and pointed to Jesus Christ and to no one else nor anything else. So, if a high school sermon could convince a young man that he was to answer the call to Christian gospel ministry because the sermon pointed him to Jesus Christ, think how much easier life will be if we look to no one but Jesus and always remember, consider, and imitate. Amen. The peace of God which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Amen. We will now sing Morning Cry on page 5 in your worship folder as the offering.
Offering is being collected in St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. Next Sunday will be our last Sunday at the drive-in, then we'll be back here. And we're having the pet blessing. Next week's our 60th a year that we've had the drive-in service. This hymn is Born in Cry. It's written by John Lavasker, Y-L-I-S-A-K-E-R. Still alive, born in 1937. I was there to hear your morning cry. We're saying that as we're taking up the offering today. We're happy to have you here today, St. John's Lutheran Church. I'm Dr. Sally Abbott, your announcer. We had a lesson today on humility and focusing on Christ. Christ is our only hope. He's the only one who has returned from the dead and has given us eternal life. We'll come to the fount of every blessing as our last hymn. And this hymn is Morning Cry. Talks about our life in Christ. We invite you to come next week, 8 o'clock at the drive-in, the pet blessing, and after that, on the 11th of September is Rally Day, when we start our Sunday school program. Finally healed from his rotator cuff surgery. He's back to normal functioning. We thank you for coming this Sunday. We hope you'll come and join us in person anytime. Remember that our only hope is in Jesus Christ, as he gave his body and his blood for us, and we receive him every day. He came back from the dead. We don't have any other example of that. We have eternal life from Jesus. Graduation. He graduated from Harvard, and then he entered the Congregational Seminary in Ministry, and he ministered in Massachusetts, Minnesota, and California. This is a famous graduation hymn. It was written by Ernest Schurfeld for his own graduation. He graduated from Harvard at the age of 26. The melody was written by a blind organist, Henry Smart, at age 23. So these are young men who have written Lead On, O King Eternal, famous graduation hymn. The author of the melody edited the hymn book of the United Presbyterian Church of Scotland. So this is an international hymn, Lead On, O King Eternal. It was written in 1887. That Jesus is our only hope, the only hope for salvation and eternal life. We've worshiped him together today, the service of the word. Next week will be the service of Holy Communion. You can see now the flowers are being taken to the shut-ins. The candles will be extinguished and the service will be over. But we've been here, we've been in the presence of Christ, and next week we receive his holy bread. We'll receive the bread from heaven, as it will be brought down from heaven and given to us. Jesus died for us, died on the cross to save us from sins, and he has returned. We have all the evidence of his return. He was alive. He spent 40 days with all of his followers and disciples, and he spends time with us too as we worship him. We're happy to have you worship here at St. John's Lutheran Church. Next Sunday is our final Sunday of the drive-in. We'll have the pet blessing. We today had the gathering hymn, which was Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing, the prayer, the scripture lessons were read by Gina Pollock, the gospel was read by Pastor Pollock, we had the hymn, This Is My Father's World, we had the affirmation of faith, special music by Harvey Baker, very good, I Want to Walk with Jesus. Today's message was Remember, Consider, Imitate. The pastor then gave us questions and things to answer as we consider, imitate, and follow Jesus. Then we sang the hymn Born in Cry, which is the second most popular hymn now in the Lutheran Church. I was here to hear your Born in Cry. Then a prayer, and the Lord's Prayer, the benediction, and the closing hymn, Lead On, O King Eternal. The closing hymn was a graduation hymn. It's a traditional graduation hymn. It's good that we're having it at this time of year, because many people have graduated and going back to college. So this is part of education, part of life, as we're here, is God is here to hear a born in cry, and he's with us even when we close our eyes. He's there when we open our eyes for the born in cry, and he's there. Jesus is there with us. He's our only hope, and he's there when we close our eyes in death. We thank you for coming to St. John's Lutheran Church, 27 North Wittenberg Avenue. We're happy to have you come anytime. We have a social ministry. We serve 8,000 meals a month to the shut-ins. So if we'd like to have you come and help us, see if you can follow what Jesus is asking. If he calls on you to be a disciple of his, don't harden your heart. Listen to what he's asking.
Absolutely.